Good morning, everyone, and welcome to today's session. My name is Swapnil Hendre. I'm a Director of Solutions Engineering and Design at VMware. I've been with VMware for about 9 years, and my team is responsible for leading solutions architecture from inception to go live. And migration to NSX Advanced Load Balancer is one of the critical projects our team is leading. During today's presentation, we will be discussing VMware IT journey to NSX Advanced Load Balancer, also known as the AVI Load Balancer. So we may use these terms interchangeably throughout the presentation, so please bear with us. I'm joined by Preeti from my team. Preeti, would you like to introduce yourself?
Sure, Swapnil, thank you. Hello, everybody, and thanks for joining this webinar. My name is Preeti. I work as a solutions engineer in Swapnil's team in VMware. I'm one of the people in his team involved in the NSX Advanced Load Balancer project.
Thank you, Preeti. So let's start with the agenda. So we'll first talk about why VMware IT considered NSX Advanced Load Balancer. Then we'll talk about where we started. What was our journey like? We'll talk about the high-level demo where we will show you the various capabilities of NSX Advanced Load Balancer or NSX ALB, which we have been using in VMware IT. And finally, we'll conclude with question and answers. We'll try to answer as many as possible the questions at the end of the presentation. So let's get started. So first, let's talk about why we considered NSX Advanced Load Balancer. See, the load balancer landscape has been changing rapidly for the last few years. And we have been facing several challenges with our legacy load balancers. We have been using our legacy load balancers for quite a few years, actually. And while it met our requirements in the past, we have been seeing several challenges with it. So why don't we start going through all these challenges one by one? The first one is the root cause analysis, which takes too long. For those who support the load balancers, they know that generally the load balancers are the entry point for all the applications. And the load balancer team is the first one to get called when there is a problem. Generally with our NSX, generally with our legacy load balancers, it takes too long for us to find out the root cause of any problem. When someone reports a problem, first of all, we don't have the historical data. Second, if you want to do a deep dive, we have to either enable the packet capture or turn on the additional logging. And more than likely, it actually adds the load on our, it added a load on our existing load balancer, which made it quite hard for us to identify a root cause of problem as quickly as possible, which resulted into the extended service degradation for several of our applications. The next one is the lack of elasticity. The legacy load balancers which we had deployed, generally we will do the capacity planning for 3 to 5 years, and then we'll procure those load balancers. And so once we procured, there was not much of elasticity. We would have to just stay with what we got. A lot of the time, we ended up doing the oversubscription to support the very critical scenarios when the load on the system is quite high. What that means is we can't really scale up or scale down the load balancer resources as we needed to. The next one is VMware is on the journey to migrate as many applications as possible to the public cloud, as public cloud provides us the various features such as the very quick go-to-market for all our applications, which means that we needed a load balancer which would provide us ability to deploy the load balancers as quickly as possible, provide the automation, provide the analytics, which will help us identify the root cause of the problems. Our legacy load balancer lacked these features. The final one is the support for the cloud native applications. In VMware, we are in the process of migrating our monolithic applications to Tanzu Kubernetes grids, which will allow us to automate our application deployment pipeline. And one of the critical component which is there for the application deployment is the integration with the load balancer. The challenge which we had was that even though we had automated our application deployment, we were not able to automate the integration of our Tanzu Kubernetes grid with the legacy load balancer. which was resulting into delays for application deployment. So while looking at this problem, we looked at the NSX advanced load balancers, and we realized that all of these problems can be solved out of box by NSX advanced load balancer. So let's start with the first one, the ease of deployment. The NSX ALB allows you to automate your load balancer component deployment very quickly using the Ansible scripts or the REST APIs. You can spin up and spin down workloads based on your requirements on the fly. The NSX ALB is 100% virtualized load balancer. Hence, it is integrated. We can integrate this with our vSphere infrastructure, which allows us to spin up and spin down the load balancer using the vSphere integration. The analytics, which is kind of the centerpiece of our load balancer, is which allows us the visibility into the application traffic flow, which we lacked in the past. And we'll discuss about that in detail throughout this presentation. Regarding the automation, we were able to integrate the NSX ALB with our Tanzu Kubernetes grid, and we were able to automate the application deployment as well as load balancer configuration provisioning so that the VIPs are created automatically whenever the workload is deployed. We were able to provide full control to our applications team. So all they have to do is whenever they are creating the namespaces, they provide the annotations for the load balancer configurations. And on the fly, the load balancer config is created. And whenever they are done with the workload and they want to spin it down, it goes in reverse order. It first automatically deletes the load balancer configuration, and then they can delete the application. And finally, the public cloud deployment. We had a requirement to support a public cloud deployment for Horizon 7 on VMware Cloud on AWS. We were able to use NSX ALB's out-of-the-box integration to meet this requirement. And we'll talk about this use case in detail when we come to that point. The next one is now, let's talk about the high-level design of the load balancer. One of the first things you will see here is your data plane and the control plane is separated. With our legacy load balancer, the data plane and the control plane was merged, which kind of prevented us from having a holistic single point of view for our entire environment. So for example, if you have a site and it has, let's say 10 pair of load balancers, and if I want to see what's going on each of them, I have to log on to each of them. With this separation of the control plane and data plane, we can log into one controller, and then we can manage all these 10 pair of load balancer from single pane of glass. The next one is the multi-cloud design. With the NSX ALB, we can deploy this on-prem in virtualized on containers, as well as the bare metal deployments, as well as in the public cloud. It provides us a unified platform so that when we do a deployment, irrespective of whether it is on-prem or the cloud, the deployments looks quite similar. The next one is the analytics or the intelligence piece. So with this integration, we have now visibility into the application performance metrics, and we can measure the end-to-end user experience or end-user experience. So if someone from application team runs into issue and they want to look into what really is happening, they can simply log in to the load balancer and look at the end-to-end response time. They can look at how much time it took from request to go from client to load balancer, load balancer to server, and server to the backend applications, which is available out of the box. We don't need to turn on any additional features for us to see this. In addition, we can also do the log analytics. So let's say you want to find out how many server 404 errors you got or server 500 errors you got throughout the day. You can simply log in and create the filters to look at that specific requirement. In this example, I'm showing that you want to look at all the traffic for the SSL TLS version 1, and you want to look at a specific URI. You can filter it on based on that. These are just examples. When Preeti goes through a demo, she will show you that you can filter on any of the parameters, such as client IP request, or even the header values. And finally, the container integration, which allows us to integrate our AVI load balancers with TKG. Now that we have gone through why we consider AVI load balancer and the high level overview, Preeti, can you take us through the lower level kind of a deep dive across the various components of the NSX Advanced Load Balancer?
Swapnil, thank you for that. Now, Swapnil has taken you through a brief overview of the functionalities that AVI has to offer. Let me walk you through the high level components and how they fit into the AVI topology. So in this diagram, you can see all the components that are involved in the AVI landscape, and they are organized. So let's take a closer look into each of these and also talk briefly about what exactly they do. So the first thing you see on the left is control cluster. As Swapnil had mentioned earlier, one of the benefits with AVI is control plane, data plane separation. The controller here is the central point of management and also acts as the brain behind the services delivered by the data plane. Controllers are usually clustered for availability purposes. Here we see three controllers, which is the recommended design. Next, we see service engines. Now, service engines are the worker nodes and handle all the data plane operations. They do this by receiving and executing the instructions from the controller or the control plane. The service engines also hold the VIPs and handles all the communications to the backend pool members, be it data traffic or also the health monitor traffic. SEs are also grouped for availability again, and they are grouped under service engine groups or SE groups. In the next panel, you can see a couple of load balancer objects, and let's go through them one by one. The first object you see is the cloud. In AVI, multiple environments can be created under the same system, and these environments are what are called clouds. All the SEs, VRFs, and VIPs in that particular environment can be grouped under that specific cloud. So for example, in your environment, you have a production cloud, then all the production SEs and the production VIPs can all be grouped under that cloud. And for the staging, you can have an entirely different set of cloud SE VIP infrastructure. Right under the cloud, you can see VRFs, which is virtual routing and forwarding. VIPs or VSS refer to virtual services, and pools are the backend members of the VIPs. The next component we can see over here are the tenants. Now, a tenant in AVI is an isolated instance, and each user account in AVI is associated with one or more tenants. The tenant defines what objects or resources a user will be able to view or access when they log in. So now that we have taken a look at all the components, I will be walking you through a couple of screenshots that we've taken from our AVI instance. This will be like a preview to the demo. And so this is just to get you familiarized with how the instance looks. So in the first screenshot that you see over here, we call this the dashboard view. This is what you see when you immediately log into the load balancer and switch into the correct tenant. So this is basically a view of all the VIPs that are there in that particular tenant. And you also see that some of them are yellow, some of them are green, and some of them are red. Those are because of the health score. The health score is associated to the application analytics profile. Now, what are the analytics profiles? So analytics profile in AVI is a way for you to define as to what a perfectly healthy application will look like. So for example, in the first app that has been maximized over here, you can see that the performance is 100, but there is a security penalty of 20, and hence the score of 80 has resulted. Now, how to exactly find out what exactly is causing the security penalty, that we will see during the demo. But this page is usually basically for you to see the overall health of your application and all your VIPs and how they stand. A few things to add here are, this analytics profile is tweakable. You can adjust it to your desired configuration. And the second thing is, this is not going to impact the flow of traffic to the VIPs in any way. So the traffic flow and all of that will be regular. This is just for you to understand what the overall health of your application is. Here we see the logs portion of the AVI VS. So let's go through this step by step. First of all, in the left image, what you see is just an expanded version of one transaction that has been recorded in one of the virtual service in Abhi. So what you can see over here is in the topmost portion, if you see, it says client, and then there is a client RTT, which is 1 millisecond. There's a server RTT. At the same time, there is an app response time, which is 4 seconds, which is slightly high. But so this pane is basically for you to get idea about what exactly are the statistics of that particular transaction. And this is available for all the transactions that are recorded. As you go through all the panes in the left image, you can also see that there are a lot of real-time insights about various parameters, like client insights are in the leftmost pane. The center pane has the virtual service IP, the SCIP, and a lot of other data. And the right one has request information, response information, etc. So these are, and you also see a button called View All Headers, which is where you can go and check what headers are being transferred, which is what Swapnil was referring to. So there is also a probability that you might want to filter through the traffic based on these parameters. That's what we are seeing in the right side image. You can filter using any parameters. We'll again cover this in detail in the demo. But for an example, you can filter using the client location or the client OS or browser or any of the parameters that you can see in the left image can be used to filter through the right image. So this screen is the client analytics screen. This is also based out of all the logs that are received that we saw in the previous step. Here you can see that it is sorted by based on location as well as browser, OS types, operating systems. You also get the top URLs accessed, and there is a percentage shown next to each of these parameters, which is collected by analyzing all the logs that are collected for that particular VS. This can also be tweaked. Like in the top right corner, you can see two boxes. One says average values that can be tweaked into like peak values or current values. And the same way, the display in real time can also be tweaked. You just have to click on the arrow button and choose whichever option you want. So this screen is about security, and this is the security pane basically in the Avi VS. Here you can see a number of details. Let's go through it pane by pane. The top left one says SSL, and here you can see details about the certificate as well as the SSL TLS version. So regarding the certificate in this one particularly, what can you see? When does a cipher become old? If it is old, then you have to deprecate it. You have to stop allowing it. Or even the TLS version, right? What all versions are allowed for your VS, and what transactions are successful, what transactions are failed. It's a brief overview of that. Right below is a pane that says SSL score. Now the SSL score overall, which is determined for the entire VS, is based on a few parameters which are again listed right below it. There is PFS support, and as you can see over here, the SSL protocol strength says SSL V3, which is the reason why the entire score is shrunk from the perfect score of 5.0 to 3.5. So this way it's just analyzed. And then the rightmost pane says DDoS. This is to show if your VS is undergoing any sort of an attack at the current point in time. If it is, then it shows you a number of analytics about the attack. And also it shows you the attack count, which is plotted in form of a graph as shown below.
Okay. Thank you, Priti. That was very good overview about the Avi capabilities. Now that we talked about the capabilities, I want to quickly walk you through the use cases which we have for which we are considering or in the process of doing the migration from our legacy load balancer to NSX Advanced Load Balancer. So this is where we started, right? The first thing we did is we identified the various use cases that we have for migrating to NSX Advanced Load Balancer, or even doing a greenfield deployment of the NSX Advanced Load Balancer. The first one is the remote site migration. VMware has several sites deployed across the globe, where we do have the legacy load balancers where they were supporting those remote sites. Followed by the Avi integration or NSX Advanced Load Balancer integration with VMware Cloud on AWS. So this is the example where we had a requirement to deploy Horizon 7 on VMware Cloud on AWS and supporting it by load balancing using NSX Advanced Load Balancer. The next one is our cloud natives integration use case, where we integrated NSX ALB with Tanzu Kubernetes Grid. And finally, the last one is the data center migration, where our goal is to migrate all of the our existing footprint where we have the load balancers to NSX Advanced Load Balancers. So let's start with the remote sites migration. Now, you might be wondering, why did we start with the remote sites migration? The reason behind that is in VMware IT, we have very well-defined process when it comes to deploying a new technology. We start with the simplest use case first. Hence, we started with the remote site deployment. With the remote site deployment, the reason the use case is simple is because we don't have that many number of VIPs. So VIPs are maybe 20 to 30 VIPs, and the complexity is considerably low as compared to our data center migration. So our approach for each of these migration is slightly different. So let me walk you through what was our approach for the remote sites migration. So for the remote site migration, so here we have, I'm giving you example of two sites, the EMEA sites, so EMEA 1 and EMEA 2. These were our legacy load balancers, and they are used to load balance several applications in each of these sites. Now, for doing the migration, our approach was that we want to ensure that the service disruption should be as less as possible, and we should be able to do the migration, and in case something goes wrong, we should be able to revert to the older configuration. So to do that, we use the configuration migration utility, which is provided by the NSX ALB, which allows you to migrate the configuration from the legacy load balancer to NSX Advanced Load Balancer. Once the migration is done, we call that process as a pre-staging. Okay, so once the pre-staging is done, then we go ahead and disable the traffic flow to our legacy load balancer, and then enable the traffic flow to our NSX Advanced Load Balancer. And then we proceed with the waiting period of 2 weeks, and then eventually go ahead and decommission the legacy load balancers. So this is kind of high level process. The step one is we deploy the controller cluster, followed by deploying the service engine group or service engine cluster in the site EMEA. And then we pre-stage the configuration. Once the configuration was pre-staged, we automated the process of redirecting traffic from legacy load balancer to NSX Advanced Load Balancer by disabling the ARP on the legacy load balancer and enabling the ARP on the NSX Advanced Load Balancer. As soon as that step was complete, the traffic started redirecting to NSX Advanced Load Balancer. Since we had scripted the entire process, the average amount of time for migration is between like 30 to 40 seconds for each of our migrations, because we are simply executing the script. All the configuration is pre-staged, and once the migration is complete, then we go ahead and do the end-to-end testing. And once the testing is complete, then we go ahead and get a sign-off. Once sign-off is done, we have a waiting period of 2 weeks. After waiting for 2 weeks, then we go ahead and start removing the legacy configuration and eventually decommissioning the legacy load balancer. The same process is followed for the next site deployment. And one thing you can see here is we had two separate pair of load balancers in our EMEA sites. And here, they both are supported by a same controller cluster. So it allows us to provide a single pane of glass view for that specific region. So this is kind of a logical topology of how our environment looks like. So we have three pair of control clusters in NASA, APAC, and EMEA, which are used to do a load balancing for all the sites in each of the region. So having this, as we discussed, provides a centralized management for each of the region. You might be wondering why don't we just merge those clusters so that you just have a single pane of view for all the sites from one single location. The reason behind that is the best practices dictate that the latency between the control cluster and the service engines should not be more than 55 milliseconds. And due to geographical limitations, we are unable to meet that requirement. Hence, each of the region, we have a separate controller cluster. It helps us do the load balancing of the each of the sites and providing single pane of glass view for each of the regions. Now that we talked about the remote site deployment, let's discuss our next use case, that NSX Advanced Load Balancer deployment for VMware Cloud on AWS. Before discussing the actual topology for the deployment, I want to quickly talk about how we actually approach the migration to VMware Cloud on AWS. So the first thing we do is we deploy all the core services locally inside the VMware Cloud on AWS, and these core services include load balancer also. The reason we deploy these core services inside the VMware Cloud on AWS is threefold. The first one is we want to reduce the latency for any applications deployed inside VMware Cloud on AWS. We want to eliminate the cost for the egress traffic. For those who have worked on the public cloud deployments, anytime you egress from public cloud and go out, you incur a cost and we have to pay for that cost. So we wanted to eliminate that. And the final portion was we wanted to eliminate dependency on on-prem infrastructure so that the cloud can continue to work even if the on-prem infrastructure has a problem. That's why here, this is kind of our overall architecture for all core services. And we secure these core services by using NSX micro-segmentation. And we have done the same thing for the load balancers in this specific scenario. Now let's kind of zero in a little bit on the load balancer deployment portion for the Horizon 7 deployment on VMware Cloud on AWS. So recently VMware had acquired two companies, and we had received a requirement to provide virtual desktop environment for this initiative within like 4 weeks or so. Now, if we wanted to deploy this on on-prem, it would have taken us 3 to 4 months to do this deployment. But VMware Cloud on AWS, we were able to spin up the workload and complete end-to-end configuration and go live within 3 weeks. And we use NSX Advanced Load Balancer for doing the load balancing. So you see the UAGs are load balanced by the front-end load balancer, followed by the connection servers, and eventually the request reaches the backend Horizon desktops. So that's kind of the end-to-end workflow for our deployment of NSX Advanced Load Balancer for supporting Horizon 7 on VMware Cloud on AWS. The next use case we have is VMware authentication application. So we had a requirement to provide 4 nines SLA for this application. So initially this application was just deployed on 2 on-prem sites, and we were not able to meet that 4 nines SLA requirement. Hence we decided to go ahead and deploy a project called as Tertiary Data Center, which allowed us to deploy the third stack of the VMware authentication application inside VMware Cloud on AWS. Since this was one of the most critical application and we were in the middle of doing the migration to VMware Cloud on AWS, we wanted to take this opportunity and introduce NSX Advanced Load Balancer in VMware Cloud on AWS, because since this was a greenfield environment, we were able to do so. So we deployed NSX Advanced Load Balancer here for this deployment. And we, as you can see here, the three-level deployment for NSX Advanced Load Balancer. So that's how we were able to meet this requirement. This was second example for public cloud deployment. So the next one is the logical overview of how our footprint looks like for the public cloud deployment. So here also we have three clusters for the public cloud deployment, and we are separating them from the on-premise deployment. And the reason we have three clusters is because we want to ensure that we don't run into the latency issues. So hence we have three separate cluster deployments. Now that we talked about public cloud deployment, let's talk about the cloud native deployment. Now the cloud native deployment, here we are going to discuss how we are integrating NSX Advanced Load Balancer with Tanzu Kubernetes Grid. So this is kind of a high level diagram about how we are doing this integration. The NSX Advanced Load Balancer is deployed as the ingress load balancer to load balance all the load balancing requests for the Tanzu Kubernetes Grid. The application owner creates the namespace at TKG or Tanzu Kubernetes Grid level. Then we have integration with NSX Advanced Load Balancer. Once the namespace is created and the annotations are provided, that information is utilized to create the virtual services. And once the virtual services are created, the virtual services are deployed and they are made available to our end user application teams. So to go a little bit deeper, we have deployed this recently. We have gone live with one of the mission critical applications in active standby mode. To ensure that we meet the SLA, we deployed this in two sites, the primary site and the secondary site. So the way it works is we have a GSLB, our Global Service Load Balancer, which routes the traffic to the active site depending on the status of the virtual server. We wanted to give control to the application teams so that the application teams can control the failover between the sites. We also use this mechanism to do the failover and do the planned maintenance with least service disruption. For example, if application team wants to deploy a new code, they first deploy it on the standby site, do the testing. Once the testing is done, the status for the active and standby is flipped and the traffic starts routing to the standby site and the deployment is done on the primary site. By doing this, we reduce the service disruption to few seconds instead of the few hours. So this is kind of the high level topology of the NSX Advanced Load Balancer. So now to talk about how this environment looks like after the deployment from the just NSX Advanced Load Balancer point of view, here also we have three clusters which are distributed across three different data centers. And then we have prod, stage, and dev for each of the environment. This is the dedicated environment for the Tanzu Kubernetes Grid deployment in three data centers. It allows the application team flexibility and ability to go ahead and do the deployment. Now let's talk about the fourth and last use case that we have, which is the data center migration. Now the data center migration is one of the most complex deployment which we have started about a month back. So the data center deployment is slightly different than all these other deployments because this is a brownfield deployment. What I mean by brownfield is that you already have hundreds of applications deployed and they are live in our environment. And we want to migrate them to NSX Advanced Load Balancer. We looked at various approaches. We looked at the gradual migration. We looked at the Big Bang approach where you just in one shot migrate everything. But to ensure that to reduce the amount of risk which you would have, we decided to do the gradual migration. So if you compare this migration with the remote sites deployment, the main difference here is that we are, instead of pre-hosting all the configuration, we host the configuration for one application at a time. So we start with the controller cluster deployment and the security group or service engine group. And once we do that, then we pre-stage the configuration for application one in this case. Once we pre-stage that configuration, then we again disable the traffic flow to the primary site and enable the traffic flow for the the NSX Advanced Load Balancer and do the end-to-end testing. Once the testing is completed, we again wait for 2 weeks and then remove the configuration from the legacy load balancer. And then we continue this process. And our goal is to, as we continue to migrate all this application one at a time, we eventually will be able to decommission all the applications from the legacy load balancer and the decommission the legacy load balancer. So this is kind of the high level process that we are going through. And to show you the kind of a logical topology, this is how it would look like. We would have several service engine groups, and they will be used to load balance several applications. Now, obviously, this is not our production topology. Just wanted to show you kind of a logical representation how this looks like for one of the regions, so that when you are ready to plan your deployment, you might want to consider similar approach. We have done so far several deployments for the data center migration, and so far they have worked out quite well. In pretty much all the use cases, our actual migration was less than 30 to 40 seconds, and it has reduced the service disruption to our applications. And this is the safest approach, because if something goes wrong, you just need to deactivate that application and reactivate on the legacy load balancer. And you, since you are doing one application at a time, risk to the business is quite low as well. So now that we have gone through in detail about our use cases, the high-level topologies, and so on, Preeti, can you take us through the demo?
Sure, Swapnil, and thank you for that. So now we will go through a brief demo of one of our non-prod environments. This demo will be mainly focused on the visibility, analytics, and troubleshooting aspects of the load balancer. We will be covering most of that. But yeah, let's dive right into it. So this is how the Avi Vantage looks as soon as you log into it. You can see that there are no virtual services in the dashboard, but that's just because we are in the admin tenant. We spoke about tenants previously. Admin is the default one. So you can see that as we scroll down, there are many tenants that have been created in this load balancer. We will be concentrating on one of the non-prod tenants that we have today. So let's jump right into that tenant by clicking on it. So once you switch tenants, you can see that the virtual services automatically populate. So before we go into the virtual services, let's talk about the infrastructure a bit first. So let's click on application and go on to infrastructure. Now on the dashboard, the first thing that populates is all the service engines that are a part of this entire load balancer. You can also see the health status. Here it says trending health score for the past month. This can be altered as per your desire to 6 hours or 30 minutes. So in case your SE has gone through any anomalies, this is very easy to figure out from this health score. So the first tab that we're going to be looking at is clouds. And as we discussed previously, clouds are created for various environments. Here we've created many clouds based on our topology. And the way to see the status of each of the clouds is to go into status column. Here everything is green and working. But in case there are some issues in configuration, this is where it'll show up. And as and when needed, a cloud can be created by clicking on the create button in the top right corner. Right after this, we'll be seeing the service engines or the worker nodes. So here we see that there are no service engines that are populated, but that's just because the correct cloud is not selected. Let's go into the same cloud that corresponds to this tenant, which is STG INT. So once you click on that, the service engines will automatically populate. As we discussed previously, we have two service engines over here, and the health is also displayed even here. So in case you click on the service engine, it'll show you a view of all the VIPs that are currently being hosted by that service engine like this. So there are 4 VIPs in the service engine, and the one right below, there are 2 VIPs. So next to the status column, you can see the SE group that is referenced, which is in fact the next component that we're going to revise. So if you click on service engine group, you can see that one service engine group has been created for this particular cloud, which has 2 service engines. If you click on this again, You will see the IPs of the two service engines that are a part of this SEG, and also all the virtual services that are being hosted in both of these SEs put together. Next, let's jump into routing, where we will look at the VRF. So if you switch to the VRF context tab, I think there is. Okay, I think there's a playback issue. Let's just wait for it. So like I had said, there's routing. And then if you switch to the VRF context tab, you can see that one VRF has been created in addition to global. Global is the default VRF. It's recommended to create a custom VRF, so that whenever if there is any need for addition of static routes, they can be created under the particular VRF. This application didn't need any, but if needed, just click on the create button and it'll pop up the window to create a static route. Now we've gone through all the infrastructure components. Now we are ready to dive into the virtual services and what information we can get there. Let's go back to applications. This is the list of VSS that we saw before. Let's click on expand all. So this is the screen that we saw in our previous screenshot. So here you see all the VIPs with different health scores. So in this VS, you can see that there has been a performance dip. The VIP has been down for a while, hence the reduction in score. And over here, I think, yeah, the VIP came up only a few hours ago, hence the reduction. So this is where you can basically see what the overall health of all the VIPs in this tenant are. And there is one which is down also, which says pools are down. And you can just hover right into the pool member and you will see that it is not responding to system TCP, which means that it's probably not reachable. So here you can see all the VIPs that are a part of this tenant, what is the health status of each, what SC is handling each of the VIPs. So brief information about all the VIPs can be seen in the dashboard view. So let's go ahead and click on one of the VIPs. So here, the first tab that you're presented with is analytics. And analytics is all about end-to-end timing. As you can see in the first portion, you can see the client RTT, server RTT, app response, data transfer, total time. And all of this is also plotted in a graph. And if you hover over certain points, the particular analytics frame for that time period will come up. You can again tweak the time and also the current values to average or peak or total values. The next tab is logs. So there are two types of logs, significant and non-significant logs. This is how you can enable the non-significant ones also. Let's switch to past week so that we get a bigger subset of transactions. Now you can see so many transactions have been collected for this particular VS, and you can click on any one of them and it'll expand to give you more information about the particular transaction. Let's go ahead and click on this one. As we saw in the screenshots portion, there are so much of information that's available over here. The client IP, port number, location is internal because this is an internal VIP, operating system, computer, browser, many client-specific information in the leftmost pane. In the middle pane, the one that you want to concentrate on is significance, which is the last option. So here, it will show you what exactly is the reason why, what is wrong with this transaction, basically. It is very useful in terms of troubleshooting. So you can also see the virtual service IP, SE IP, what server is handling this traffic, and there it is, the significance that we spoke about. So it says high app response time. It has resulted in a 200. Looks like it's stuck again.
Let's continue.
Okay, yeah. So it has resulted in a 200, but even then, it's just giving you a warning that the app response time is higher than expected, which is 2 seconds in this case. So this kind of statistics will really help you while troubleshooting. For example, let's see one of the 404 transactions over here. So when you expand that and when you see the significance, it will show you that the response code is 404. So whatever has been given by the server has been channeled back into the client by AV. So this is how you can use this information to troubleshoot. So one more thing that you can do over here is in case you want to revisit one transaction that happened yesterday, you don't have to revise through all of these logs to go to that time frame. You can just click on that particular time frame and zoom to select it. That way, only that particular time's transactions will be shown to you. So this is how you do that. let's go back to the past week. There's a couple more things we need to see. So yeah, one other important thing is to filter through the logs. So if you go and click on the search portion, it will prompt you with a lot of queries that can be given. And there, if you give client browser, it will give you all the types of options. And if you give Chrome and press enter, it will filter all the transactions that have come from the client browser, which is Chrome alone. So you can keep on filtering like this, or even expand this and probably click on the URI. For example, if you do that, then all the transactions which have that URI path will come up, and you can further filter on terms of operating system or anything of that sort. So filtering can be done on any of the parameters that are present. So on the right side, you can see there are a lot of analytics that are collected. This can be used in situations where you're presented with a problem. Say your application team is facing an issue, but you don't really know what the cause is. They tell you, like, I'm starting from this client IP, or this is what the response says to me. Say suppose they say the connection was aborted. Then in that case, you can go ahead and click on the connection abnormal event and see what all transactions have been aborted because of that reason. So this gives you the ability to backtrack from the issue to the cause, which is very useful in terms of troubleshooting. So here you can see that there is a significance that has the same thing that we researched. Next, let's go on to health. This is related to the health score. Like we saw, this is 80, which is 20 less than the perfect score of 100. Even though the performance score is given as 100, the security threat is what is reducing it. So if you click on that more, you can find out as to what exactly is causing this reduction in score, and you can analyze more about that. Now, if you go to the security tab, this also, I think we visited during our screenshots. So this is going to give you a holistic view of the security of the VS. You can see the certificate and the TLS version specifications, the SSL score, and also if you're going through any DDoS attacks at that time frame. Events is basically pull up, pull down, VS up, VS down kind of alerts. These can also be sent to your Splunk servers or your mailboxes if that's necessary. Now, this is about VIPs. So in pools, it's the same information that you saw in VIPs pretty much. So the list will be there, and it's almost the same tabs to navigate through to get whatever information you need. That's pretty much it for this demo.
Thank you, Priti. Now that we have gone through the demo, I would like to quickly wrap up with VMware IT journey about where we started and where we are heading, and then we'll take some questions. So we started our journey back in July 2019. Our first deployment was our remote sites deployment, which we did in the Amsterdam. And followed by, we did deployment on VMware Cloud on AWS, as well as the cloud native deployment. We recently went live in March. And finally, we are in the process of doing the migration to the migration of our production data center. I would love to stand here and say we didn't face any problems, but that's never the case when you are deploying or migrating any critical applications to a newer platform, a newer technology. And we did face some of those issues. We have a very good communication with our R&D team. So whenever we face any issues, we work with our R&D team to address that. To give you an example, one of those issues where the destination persistence was a requirement for one of our mission critical applications, and it was not, that feature wasn't available. So we worked with R&D and addressed that feature. So our goal always is to ensure that whatever problems we face, our customers are going to face the same problem sooner than later. So we are early adopters of this solution, but we do have a feedback loop so that you guys don't have to face the problems we faced. Another thing which we have seen throughout our deployment is it has improved our ability for our applications team's ability to troubleshoot and look at the issues quickly. We have granted the read-only access to all our applications team so that they can look at it, the transactions directly by logging into the NSX Advanced Load Balancer. It's not a black box for them anymore. It helps identify the root cause of the problem, and it also helps with the deployment. Now, talking about the automation has helped us a lot, but we are just starting our journey on the automation front as well. With that said, I would like to thank everyone for joining today's session and hope you found this was useful. And at this point, we're going to pause and look at the questions. If you haven't posted your question, please take time to post it and we'll try to answer them. So I'm going to start going through each of the questions one by one. The first question is, NSX Advanced Load Balancer, is it a public cloud offering? So it is just to clarify. So NSX Advanced Load Balancer, also known as AVI or NSX ALB, can be deployed either on the public cloud or private cloud. You can deploy it on AWS, Azure, VMware Cloud on AWS, or in your private cloud deployment that is supported, as well as the integration with the cloud native. So the next question is that, let me see, can you talk about the hardware requirements and licensing? So for hardware requirements, I would suggest logging on to the VMware site. The hardware requirements are provided in detail on our VMware's website. Regarding the licensing, I would suggest you reach out to your account representative and they can help you with that. Okay, let's see. So are there, let me see, is this mandatory to have NSX or AVI load balancer with TKG, or NSX T load balancer would suffice the requirement? If not, why? There are two types of load balancers, right? There is a NSX load balancer, which provides the basic functionalities. But with the NSX advanced load balancer, you can see a lot more advanced features and functionalities that you see here, such as the automation, as well as the analytics piece and so on. So you can choose what your requirements are. Based on our requirements, we needed all those advanced functionalities so that we can reduce the time it takes to identify the root cause. So we use that. But NSX load balancer can also work, but our recommendation to use NSX advanced load balancer. Okay, let me see other questions. So there is a question called as, can NSX advanced load balancer be used to replace existing GLB infrastructure? So I assume you mean GSLB or Global Service Load Balancer. So in addition to NSX advanced load balancer, there is a GSLB offering as well. So you can use the NSX advanced load balancer as a global service load balancer as well. And we definitely have plans ourselves to do that. But our first goal is to complete the migration of all our virtual services. And once that is done, then we are going to replace our existing GSLBs or legacy GSLBs with NSX Advanced Load Balancer GSLB as well. Okay, let's see. So can NSX ALB be used for load balancing traffic among the network firewalls? So I'm not 100% certain. The more details probably will help me answer these questions. So I don't know if the question is that, can you use the NSX advanced load balancer to, so for example, we have a firewall sandwich. So we have layer one firewall, layer two firewall. So if the question is, can you load balance the workload in layer two using the layer one? So answer is yes, it can be done. But if that's not what you're looking for, feel free to post your comments and then we'll try to answer that in more details. Okay, I think we have answered most of the questions so far. So we'll wait for another couple of minutes. Okay, let's see. Is NSX Advanced load balancer included with NSXT license? I would like to recommend that you reach out to your account representative to talk about licensing. So we are part of VMware IT. So we are actually consumers of this product. So I would recommend you discussing this with your account representative. They will be able to answer it better. Let's see, So there is a question, can NSX Advanced Load Balancer be used in tandem with NSX Advanced Load Balancer, or is it preferred to use just one or other? Specifically like GTM and LTM solution. So there is definitely interoperability. So you can use both of them in parallel if that's what your requirement is. In our case, we are just going with one platform for consistency and providing the end-to-end visibility. So we are specifically using NSX Advanced Load Balancer. Okay, we'll wait for another couple of minutes. Are there any more questions coming? Okay, I think we are getting closer to the top of the hour. So again, we would like to thank you for joining this webinar. Hope you found it useful. If you would like to do a deep dive and have a specific session with your own IT infrastructure team, feel free to reach out to VMware and VMware team to schedule a briefing if you would like to do a deep dive. But at this point, again, I want to thank everyone for your time. And you have a good day.
Thank you, everybody.